Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to this plenary session, A Cure for HIV. I'm very happy to chair this session with Alain. And in introduction, I would like to remind you that ISHEID, not with the name ISHEID, ISHEID is born in early 90s. And I remember that at this time, I have said that to fight a chronic disease, it's important to organize a chronic symposium. And I'm sure, dear colleague, that you are okay with me to congratulate Alain for his chronic presence. Thank you for your deed and for always do.
Thank you. You want to say my persistence.
And it's important for me, old virologist. It's really, really important for the next generation. And when I see Mathieu Godino, a clinician in Lyon, when I see Miguel from Porto or Portugal, it's important. You are the future. Thank you. Alain. And the future, in the future, there is a hope for cure. And I am very, very happy, and it's an honor for me to introduce the first speaker, Liang Shan from Johns Hopkins University in Baltimore, in the group of Robert Siliciano. And your papers, your many original papers, are always very interesting and very well illustrated, and it's important for a small virologist to understand. Thank you very much to be here, Liang.
Thank you very much for the nice introduction. And just a quick update, I recently moved to Yale University. And first of all, I want to thank ISHEID and Alain for inviting me to present my recent work here. It's a great honor. So art does not eradicate HIV infection. What it does is to reduce the plasma viral RNA to the level below 50 copies per mil, which is the detection limit of most of the clinical assays. And if we use super sensitive assays, such as single copy assay, and a low level residual viremia can be consistently detected in patients on heart, which means these patients are still viremic. And this residual viremia is mainly contributed by a stable viral reservoir that are not affected by any category of antiretroviral drugs. And the most well-categorized reservoir for latent HIV-1 is resting memory CD4 T cells. Because the long half-life of resting memory CD4 T cells, this reservoir is extremely stable, and it takes up to 70 years for this reservoir to fully decay. And this reservoir has the ability to produce replication-competent virus upon stimulation and fully rekindle infection within a few weeks if the treatment is stopped or interrupted. Therefore, patients has to stay on treatment for lifelong, which creates a lot of issues, as a lot of people discussed in the past few days. So we need to find a way to clear the latent reservoir in order to cure a patient. However, it's not well understood how HIV establishes latent infection in these cells. So there are a few possible mechanisms that can explain. Either naive or memory resting CD4 T cells encounter cognate antigen and become activated CD4 T cells. And they're very susceptible to viral infection. And then some of them survive and revert back to resting memory stage. Another possibility is that the virus directly infect resting memory CD4 T cells and become latent reservoir. So to investigate these mechanisms, we use our in vitro model, and we infect either activated or resting memory CD4 T cells with our reporter virus, and measure the frequency of latent reservoir. So we start with X4 tropic virus, as a lot of in vitro models do. And we can easily detect latent virus in both populations. However, R5 tropic virus is more relevant because it dominates in the latent reservoir in vivo. Surprisingly, we're not able to detect any latent virus in our in vitro model if we use R5 tropic virus for the infection. So we decide to do step-by-step analysis to determine what kind of cells can support latent infection by R5 tropic virus. So in order to complete a latent infection, the virus has to complete entry, reverse transcription, integration, but then its gene transcription has to be silenced. So we first look at the entry, which is largely determined by the level of receptor and co-receptor expression. In both resting or activated CD4 T cells, we can see a high level of CXCR4 expression, but very limited level of CCR5 expression. But after the antigen or stimuli is removed, the cells quickly become memory precursor cells. And we can see the downregulation of proliferation marker, activation marker, but surprisingly, we see a quick upregulation of CCR5 protein on the cell surface. And these cells might be ideal targets for viral entry. Next, we look at the reverse transcription level. As we all know that in activated CD4 T cells, the reverse transcription is very efficient, but this is not efficient in resting CD4 T cells. And in memory precursor cells, as we shown here, it's partially active, which means these cells can partially support, or at least a fraction of cells should be permissive for reverse transcription. And next, we look at the viral gene transcription. We first look at the global transcriptional profile of these different subsets. Once the cells are activated, numerous genes are greatly up or downregulated. But when they become memory precursors, the levels of gene transcription becomes very similar to what in resting CD4 T cells. And we specifically look at the NF-kappa-B responsive genes, because HIV gene transcription is largely regulated by NF-kappa-B. So in activated CD4 T cells, as expected, these NF-kappa-B responsive genes are highly upregulated. But once the cells become memory precursors, a rapid downregulation of NF-kappa-B responsive genes is observed. And the regulation of these genes might be very similar to that of HIV gene transcription. So next, we look at the viral gene transcription in these cell subsets. So in some of the memory precursor cells, the viral gene transcription level is very similar to resting cells, which is minimal gene transcriptional activity. Whereas in activated CD4 T cells, the viral gene transcription activity is extremely high, which indicates that it's very unlikely that the virus can enter latent infection. So it's not surprising that we can see the accumulation of viral latent reservoir when the virus initiates infection in memory precursor cells. So this is the model that we want to demonstrate how memory precursors are the preferential target for viral latent infection. So when resting CD4 T cells encounter cognate antigen, gets activated, and after removal or clearance of antigen, it rapidly become memory precursor cells and eventually become quiescent memory cells. And the viral entry in memory precursor cells is very efficient due to the highly expression of CCR5 co-receptor. And also, the memory precursor cells can support reverse transcription, but as minimal support for viral gene transcription. So there comes a window that only occurred in memory precursor cells, that virus has the optimal cellular environment for latent infection. And then for these latently infected memory precursors, they can fully differentiate into central or effector memory cells. As previously proposed, we believe that the eradication of latent reservoir requires both a small molecule that can reactivate latent HIV-1 plus the stimulation of HIV-1 specific CTLs. So we look at this in our model. We purify the memory precursor cells and infect them with our virus, and we can easily generate a lot of latently infected CD4 T cells. And with the presence of pre-stimulated GAC-specific CD8-positive T cells, the establishment of latent reservoir is greatly inhibited. So next, we want to do an individual level analysis of virus-specific CD8 T cells on latent reservoir. So we start with, for example, here we have a HLA-A2 positive patient. And for HLA-A2 positive patient, they normally recognize a GAC peptide named SL9 with the first amino acid S and the last L. 75% or more of the HLA-A2 positive patient develop a dominant CTL clone against this peptide. And in HLA-A3 positive patient, they generate predominant clone against RK9 epitope. So we look at whether these antigen-specific CTLs can mediate clearance of latent reservoir. Unfortunately, they can't in both situations. So next, we look at what happened, why they can't. In patients who received antiretroviral therapy after chronic infection, these are all A2 positive patients. We can easily see that in the latent reservoir, all the virus carry escape mutation, particularly on SL9 epitope. And more interestingly, for the patients who received treatment during the early stage of infection, there was no such accumulation of escape mutations. We also look at the HLA-A3 positive patient. We see the similar accumulation of RK9 escape mutations. But in patients who received treatment during the early stage of infection, no such accumulation can be observed. This is the summary pie chart. So in acute phase treated patients, only 1 out of 6 patients accumulate antigen-specific CTL escape mutations. Whereas in chronic phase treated patient, every patient accumulate a significant number of escape mutant in the latent reservoir. And this will really hurt the eradication strategy based on CTL response. So we want to know whether this patient has the ability to develop a secondary CTL response to target the escape epitope. The answer is no, they can't. So in all of these patients, their dominant CTL clones are still against the wild-type epitope. For example, in A2, it's SL9. In A3, it's RK9. In B57, it's TW10. But they're not able to develop secondary T-cell response to target the mutated epitope. So that's why this patient cannot clear their latent virus because of the escape mutation and lack of secondary T-cell response. So we have to look at the whole GAC protein, try to see what other options. The top one is an A2 positive patient. We see the SL9 escape is dominant. But fortunately, we see another 2 epitopes that are predicted to be recognized by A2 positive patient, which is WF9 or EW10. And in an A3 positive patient, we see RK9 or LY9 already escaped. But fortunately, there is TL9 or GL9 that are not escaped, which are predicted to be recognized by A3 positive patient. So we did another interferon gamma ELISpot spot assay to try to see if the patient contained these subdominant CTL clones. We say it's subdominant because during the course of infection, these CTL clones fail to put any pressure on the virus. It's probably outcompeted by dominant CTL clones. But fortunately, both patients have the low number of these CTL clones that target unmutated epitopes. For example, WF9 or EW10 in this A2 patient, or another two epitopes in A3 patient. So next, we want to see if we can get a boosted CTL response against those unmutated epitopes in order to clear latent reservoir. What we see is that we see good response. If we use the epitope-specific CTL clones in both patients, we see an increased clearance of latent HIV-1 infected cells. And if we combine those subdominant clones, we see a much better response. So to conclude, in patients who received early treatment during the acute phase of infection, we see much smaller size of latent reservoir, and more importantly, in their latent reservoir, the virus are still wild type. And perhaps an ideal situation would be the patient who received early treatment developed already CTL response, but that CTL response has not drive the escape mutation yet, which means they have the dominant CTL response, but due to the initiation of heart, the viral evolution stops. It's possible that this strategy could lead to post-treatment controller, but it's just a hypothesis. And for patients who are chronically infected before initiation of treatment, we can see that due to the delay of treatment, the pre-existing reservoir dominant by wild-type virus has shifted to the escape mutants. And due to the escape mutants, the dominant CTL clones cannot clear them. So they have a much bigger size of latent reservoir, and this latent reservoir cannot be cleared by the dominant CTL clones. So I want to thank my PhD mentor Robert Silicano, and my collaborators in Silicano Lab, and my previous and current institutes, and also Dr. Stephen Dix for kindly providing all the patient samples and suggestions, and all the funding agencies. Thank you very much. I'll be happy to take questions.
Yes, Jean-Pierre.
Magnificent presentation. Thank you very much. So I have two questions and comments. So for the beginning of your presentation, you say that is mainly CCR5 expressing cells that are more prone to be infected. Mm-hmm. As a question, do you think the Mississippi baby may be a spontaneous cure, even in absence of heart, because maybe in a natural evolution of babies, they may have virus, but as they are a virgin immune system, they have no space for HIV, and maybe that's why only 10% may get infected in absence of infection or disease. So that's the first question.
So I don't know the answer, but I can try to explain. So first of all, CCR5 is not expressed in naive CD4 T cells. So in a newborn, majority of the CD4 or CD8 T cells are naive resting CD4 T cells, which indicates that they're not permissive to R5 tropic virus infection. That really decreases the possibility that latent reservoir can be established in these babies. So with the short period of heart treatment, the virus are cleared without the presence of latent reservoir. That's my speculation.
Okay, so thank you, because that can be a possibility on top of giving heart post-birth. Second question, in your data for very early, you have some CTL and then escape CTL. But to see a difference, why during chronic infection, CTL may not be able to clear the virus, maybe also because the help or CD4 help may be damaged, and therefore, even in the reservoir is bigger, maybe still under the potency of the immune system to remove, but maybe the lack of CD4 help may explain the difference, because a CTL may be a CTL if it is a good virus, a good epitope.
It's possible that the depletion of CD4 T cells and diminished T helper function will affect the CD8 T cell function. And actually, in fact, the CD8 T cells from patient on heart are greatly exhausted, or especially in viremic patient without treatment. But another possibility is that the virus escaped, and then the dominant clones still dominant that outcompete the other subdominant clones, which prevent the further clearance of escape mutations. So it's the competition, and the determination of dominant CTL clones is very complicated, but it has something to do with the antigen presentation. For example, a peptide is preferentially presented, for example, in A2 patient, like SL9 or other epitopes, but the other epitope are not preferentially presented. So there is the competition advantage for SL9 specific CTL clones, because that peptide is always presented at the higher priority, whereas the other epitopes are not. So I think it's a multifactory process that contribute to the escape and lack of clearance of those escape virus.
Liang, congratulations on your studies and your talk. Very nice. Couple of questions. Back to the in vitro establishment of the reservoir, right? Clearly the X4 viruses, when we study them in vitro, they seem to be much more well-equipped to replicate. But yet in vivo we know that the only virus that goes through the bottleneck and successfully establishes an infection is an R5, which is another mystery. The question is, if we try to see by cell-cell contact rather than by free virus, you can overcome the possibility to establish an R5 in latent infection?
Yeah, that's probably another mechanism that virus can establish an infection. I have not looked at the cell-to-cell transmission pathway or mechanism in order to establish latent infection, but that's definitely possible.
You know, dendritic cell or macrophage
During the interaction between APC and the T cells, the virus could be passed.
And the second is a little bit provocative. So which of the two models, or do you think that the two models are alternatively, or there could be both valid ways to establish the reservoir, infection of the activated cells versus direct infection of the memory cells that you discuss?
So CCR5 expression, well, let's talk about the infection, direct infection, not the cell-to-cell transmission, because that's more complicated. In direct infection, obviously the core receptor expression is critical. And for memory, especially quiescent memory CD4 T cells, from precursor memory to those quiescent memory, the CCR5 expression is gradually downregulated down to the undetectable level. So directly infecting those, especially central memory CD4 T cells, is less unlikely because they don't express the core receptor. Well, it's also possible that there are other core receptor usage, such as CCR3 or 6. But since CCR5 is the most dominant core receptor for M or R5 tropic virus, so I think it's less likely that directly infecting resting memory CD4 T cells could contribute significantly to the latent reservoir.
Yes?
Thank you for this incredibly interesting presentation. I was just impressed by the short time at which you suppose this escape mutation can be fixed in the viral population, because you made the distinction: if patients are treated in the acute phase, they don't have it; if they are treated lately, because some escape mutations have been shown to accumulate over years after infection. So, do you have, let's say, data, or do you think that this is really the case for this mutation, that it is established in the first few weeks, few months, or there may be a longer window of opportunity to start hard in order to avoid this mutation?
So we do not have a time course data to show how the gradually changed from the wild type to the mutant. But my speculation is that the escape mutation that we're looking at is in GAG. So normally, at the early stage of CTL response, the CTL clones normally targets TET or NEF, and the GAG, while specific CTL clones, arise later. So during the acute phase patient that received treatment during the early phase, it's possible that they already generate escape mutation in the NEF or TET region, but not yet in GAG-specific regions. And since GAG is a more conserved gene, so it's always a better target for CTL-based strategy. And in chronically infected patient, what happens, this is pure speculation because I don't have data, but what happens is there is a pre-existing latent reservoir that archive wild-type virus. But these patients has the dominant CTL clones that can gradually clear those latent reservoirs, because those reservoirs stochastically express virus genes. But when the escape mutation, escape mutant virus dominant in the plasma and gradually archived into a latent reservoir, it replaces the wild type by two ways. First, the wild type is preferentially clear. And second, there is no wild type virus to replenish the latent reservoir. So that's perhaps why in chronically infected patient, the escape mutant virus is very dominant.
From your experiment, some very nice work you made, your expectation now is that a reservoir no longer in sanctuary, but in blood. Because why you think that the main theory up to now was that the CTL could not access to the reservoir cells. Why you think the reservoir might not be in sanctuary?
That's the very practical problem, is that we can only sample cells from the periphery. So I'm not sure, for example, in the CNS, that maybe the reservoir still remain wild type, but we don't have access to those samples, or limited access, or in the gut or other periphery tissues. So I cannot exclude the possibility that the wild type virus are still dominant in those locations. But again, if that's the case, it's not a truly worrisome problem, because as long as they're wild type, they can be cleared.
No more question or comment. So thank you very much again.
Thank you.
Not only for the brilliant presentation, but for the brilliant work. So now we will move to the possible strategies, pharmacological strategies, to try to control or cure or put into remission the HIV virus. And it's my pleasure to ask Dr. Ole Schmelz Sjogard, it's okay? to tell us where we are.
Thank you, Alain. And th- thank you very much for this opportunity to present these data today. All right, so I was asked to give a kind of overview of the pharmacological approaches that are being pursued to cure HIV. So luckily, Liang has saved me some time because he already presented this data. So just the mechanism behind viral persistence. So we see persistent low-level viral viremia after the initiation of heart. And this is very stable once we get out to 1 to 2 years after treatment initiation. So as Liang very nicely described, the reason for this persistent viremia is the release of virions from latently infected cells. So normally, productively infected cells die within 24 hours or so, but sometimes we have this quiescent, or they revert to a quiescent stage, or maybe as Liang said, it's infection of a precursor state of memory cells that are being infected. In any case, these quiescent cells where there is little or no HIV transcription can be stochastically activated and start producing virions. Very often when we talk about a cure for HIV, there are different definitions. So what do we actually mean when we say a cure for HIV? Well, it can mean at least one of the two, either a sterilizing cure, that is a cure where there is no viral remnants left in a patient. An example of this would be Mr. Timothy Ray Brown, the very famous Berlin patient whom you probably all know was cured for HIV after receiving bone marrow transplant from a Delta 32 homozygous donor. So in this situation, there'll be no detectable HIV DNA, no detectable HIV RNA. Perhaps a less ambitious cure would be a so-called functional cure, where there's still some sort of low-level viral replication, but there's no disease progression. So an example of that, or at least something that would resemble that, would be elite controllers or the so-called post-treatment controllers, which have been very nicely described in the Visconti cohort. So what can be done to achieve one of these two stages? Well, there's very early treatment, which is very hard at the moment. So you probably all know the story of the Mississippi baby. This was a baby born to an HIV positive mother who was not receiving antenatal care and who was not on antiretroviral treatment at the time of birth. This baby was put on antiretroviral treatment 30 hours after birth and quickly achieved viral suppression from a baseline level of 20,000 copies per milliliter. This baby was lost to care, or at least for a period, was not seen at the hospital around 18 months of age. And when she returned half a year later, it was discovered that she did not receive antiretroviral treatment for this period. Despite this, she had undetectable HIV RNA in plasma, and subsequently, investigations for HIV RNA and viral outgrowth assays were unable to detect any virus in this baby. So very early treatment in this case possibly prevented the formation of a permanent reservoir, and this may be the mechanism behind a cure in this case. Multiple approaches have been used to enhance the immunity, and the purpose or the idea behind this strategy is to induce immunological control of viral replication in a patient. So it's very important to stress that in a cure context, this type of interventions will not remove the viral reservoir, but the target is to control the viral reservoir by controlling viral replication. And in a HIV cure context, another or a subsequent goal can be to remove cells that are being either stochastically activated or purposely activated with latency reversing agents. So multiple approaches have been used, like Leon just said, CTL targeted approaches with either therapeutic vaccines or, as is also being developed now, anti-PD-L1 antibodies to enhance CTL cytolysis. Also, NK cell targeted therapies are being investigated. Some of you might know the interferon trial that was conducted by Louis Montagnier a few years back, where in a subset of patients that received pegylated interferon alpha as monotherapy, were actually able to control viral replication for a prolonged period of time. TLR agonists have also been used to enhance NK cell activities, both in cancer trials, but it's also being considered in an HIV context. Bispecific antibodies is a relatively new concept where you have an antibody that cross-links HIV envelope epitopes and CD4 on T cells, and this actually neutralizes the variants and seems highly effective, at least ex vivo, in neutralizing virus. Another interesting concept is the use of immunotoxins. This has been tested in Victor Garcia's lab and published by Paul Denton, that an antibody targeted towards HIV envelope and carrying an immunotoxin is able to completely neutralize productively infected cells when given concomitantly with antiretroviral treatment. Also, there's a range of monoclonal antibodies being carried forward, and some very exciting studies also recently published by Dan Beruth on this approach. Well, so what can we do about the state of latency? This is something which is fairly new, is to induce a state of hyper or super latency, as it can be called. So one of the compounds that has been tested in this context is something called cortistatin, which is actually a analog of compound isolated from a marine sponge. This cortistatin A binds to the TAT, HIV TAT, and it prevents HIV transcription. So what it looks like in context of avaremic patients is that when you add this compound to resting CD4 memory cells, you actually almost completely suppress up to a level of more than 99% the residual HIV transcription in these cells. So you can actually suppress residual transcription. So it's the notion is to induce a state of latency which cannot be reactivated by stochastic events. So the opposite of this approach would be to purposely induce or reverse latency, and this is probably the approach that has received the most attention. It is also the approach that we have spent quite a lot of time working with at our institution. So it was proposed by Stephen Deeks a few years back that if you had latently infected cells, you could purposely try to reactivate the transcription and to have virion production in these cells. If you did this while patients were on heart, well, there might actually be a chance that cells became visible to the immune system and you have immune-mediated killing of the reactivated cells. And if you imagine that this can be done to all inducible latently infected cells, well, then you actually might achieve a functional cure of HIV or a sterilizing cure. So one of the reactivating agents that have been used a lot and tested a lot is HDAC inhibitors. So it's a class of drugs that relaxes the chromatin in transcriptionally silent cells, and by relaxing the chromatin, HIV transcription can take place. The first study, a pioneering study done by Dave Margolis, showed that in resting memory state cells from avaremic HIV patients, it was possible to see up to a 4.8 increase in cellular RNA. So they saw an increase in the amount of HIV RNA within the cells. They couldn't measure an increase in HIV RNA in plasma, so it was a cellular surrogate marker of increased HIV expression. So they didn't actually register any production of variants, but it was a single-dose study. We have tried to compare some different HDAC inhibitors to see if any of them would be more potent than vorinostat, which Dave Margolis used. So in latently infected cell lines, we found that another compound called panobinostat seemed to be about 100-fold more potent than vorinostat. This compound is being developed by Novartis. It's in phase three trials for multiple myeloma. It is not registered. It is not registered yet in the U.S. or in Europe for this indication. So it's still under development. So we designed a study. Novartis delivered the drug, and the study design was like this. So we had a baseline period before giving panobinostat where we measured reservoir size and transcriptional activity. Then we gave a total of 8 weeks of panobinostat. It was three doses of three pills a week, then a pause week, and then we repeat that four times. So altogether, 8 weeks of treatment. Then we had a follow-up period where we measured transcriptional activity and the reservoir size. So histone acetylation is a direct pharmacodynamic marker of the activity of HDAC inhibitors. So it increased very nicely. So the dosing, the blue arrows indicate the dosing of panobinostat, and you can see that histone acetylation increased rapidly. So within 2 hours of taking a pill, we could actually measure a significant increase in histone acetylation in lymphocytes. So this is just telling us that the drug is working like it's anticipated, at least on histone acetylation. Next, we went on to measure HIV transcription. So we did that similar to Dave Margolis and Sean Lewin by measuring unspiced HIV RNA GAC in total CD4 T cells. This also increased very nicely with a cyclic pattern similar to what we saw with histone acetylation. And the median maximal fold increase was 3.5-fold. So at least on cellular level, we were able to show that panobinostat could significantly induce HIV transcription. So what about extracellular HIV? So could we actually measure a change in plasma viremia? So to investigate this, because these patients were really well suppressed, we used a transcription-mediated amplification assay. This is the same assay that is being used by many blood banks to detect very early HIV infection. So it gives you a yes or no answer whether there is HIV RNA being detected in plasma. What we found was that during panobinostat treatment, there was significantly more samples being positive for HIV RNA compared to at baseline. So what this tells us is that not only do we see an increase in HIV transcription at a cellular level, we actually see increased plasma viremia. This was highly significant when put into a logistic model. So we successfully proved or provide proof of concept that panobinostat can provide the kick to reverse latency. So the next question was, what happened to the reservoir? So did we actually get a killing of these cells that had been reactivated, or what happened? We asked the patients to take an optional analytical treatment interruption. So it was optional, and we did this after almost near 9 months after the completion of panobinostat. So it was quite a while after doing the actual trial. 9 of the 15 patients that were in the original trial consented to go off heart for a period of time. So the way we did it was we monitored viral load twice a week and CD4 cell count once a week to have a very close view of what was going on. As you can see here, most of the patients rebounded fairly quickly. That is around day 10, day 14. A few of the patients rebound a little bit later, and you can see the patient which has ID before rebounded more than 6 weeks after withdrawing antiretroviral therapy. So obviously none of these patients had been cured. So we went back and we looked at HIV DNA to see what was actually happened in total HIV DNA during this trial. Interestingly, there was a transient decrease in the beginning of penobinostat dosing. This was significant for the patient's group, but you can see it quickly comes back to normal level, and on a group level, there is no significant decline in HIV DNA, total HIV DNA, during treatment or follow-up. So we looked at the patient's individual patterns of HIV DNA and went back to see the three patients that rebounded at the latest time point, did they differ from the other patients that did the treatment interruption? And actually, as you can see here to the right, these patients had a very different curve of HIV DNA during treatment. So they had a rapid decrease, but they never returned up to baseline again in total HIV DNA. So what this suggests is that maybe some patients are able to clear these latently reactivated cells. So latently infected cells being reactivated, some patients may actually be able to clear them while others may not be able to clear them. So we just did some correlations and we tried to look the baseline level of HIV DNA. So before these patients received any penobinostat, so way back at the screen period, the level of HIV DNA at this time point, did that tell us anything about time to viral rebound a year later? So there was no correlation whatsoever. So there was the baseline level of HIV DNA did not predict time to viral rebound. Then we calculated the delta value, so the change in HIV DNA from the before penobinostat to after penobinostat treatment. So this change in HIV DNA, does that tell us anything about how long it takes for these patients to rebound? And actually, we found a highly significant correlation between this delta change and total HIV DNA, and it was actually the same correlation we saw when we did the calculation with integrated HIV DNA. So this actually suggests that maybe HIV DNA changes can be used as surrogate marker of time to viral rebound. So it actually may be a useful marker to predict how long can these patients stay off heart, because we really lack some biomarkers for predicting what happens once patients are off heart. So this may be useful for that. Okay, so I've just been going through these different strategies. So we have pharmacological strategies that aim to reduce the size of the reservoir upfront, so at the time of infection or immediately after infection. These are treatment targeted toward limiting the expansion of the reservoir, and this is something which only applies to newly infected patients and not to the chronic infected patients. Then we have all these immune enhancement strategies that really, some of them seem very promising, but alone they will not be able to clear the reservoir. And then we have this third strategy, which is to alter the state of latency. So can we either increase latency so it cannot be induced by any mechanism, or can we actually reactivate cells? So it's not going to be easy to find a cure with these pharmacological strategies for HIV. It's a pretty tough goal. Luckily, there are multiple strategies being investigated, and I think we will need multiple strategies, and many will fail, but hopefully some will be taken forward. What is encouraging is that we already have some first successes. So we know that latency reversing agents can kick HIV out latency, both at a cellular level, but also to a level where it can be detected in plasma. We also know that early treatment limits the size of the reservoir, and in some special cases, like the Mississippi baby, it may actually be a way to cure patients. We will probably need to combine several of these strategies to achieve the ultimate goal of achieving a cure for HIV, but I think we have taken perhaps the first few steps towards this long journey towards a cure for HIV. So many people to thank. These are especially my colleagues at Aarhus University who have done these clinical trials with me. but also our collaborators at Reagan, Matthias Lichterfeld and Sarah Palmer in Sydney, as well as Jean-Louis in Melbourne and Charleston Rill in Colorado. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Some question?
Very nice study. So in your model, as the compound you plan to use is used in myeloma, where it's a dormant B cell or plasma cell, so they may impact dormant plasma cell by epigenetic regulation of apoptosis. So in your model, how can you assess for the potential, it's normal cell or not cancerous cell, but how can this compound can be linked to neutropenia, cytopenia, and induce, at least for the design cancer target, to induce apoptosis, how it may mitigate your result or may impact on T-cell recovery, T-cell decline, and in a mixture with epigenetic expansion of the virus?
Yeah. So I didn't show you the graphs on the various white blood cell levels. So CD4 cell counts were completely stable throughout the treatment. We did see a decline in thrombocytes, but it was still within the normal range. And it was same with neutrophils. So it does induce some changes to the production of white blood cells, but it's reversible things that happen. Also, we looked to see, because this has been another concern with ASEC inhibitors, if there was any reactivating of CMV or EBV, because this is, I guess, plausible. And we didn't measure any, or we didn't see any reactivation of EBV or CMV.
Hi, David Miller with the Cornell ACTG CAB. So we're expecting a lot more of the proposals on HDAC inhibitors coming out of the 20th World AIDS Conference, and you did a very nice presentation here. But I'm wondering why we're not looking at HDACs with viral host restrictive factors. There are several very, very early stage therapeutics moving forward to address APOBEC3G, PD-1, and it would seem very important that we have a secondary line of defense once we activate these viral reservoirs, given that A, we've never really done this on a mass scale, and we don't know what kind of minority subspecies are going to exit that cave. And it's not a good idea to poke a dragon in the eye unless you really know you're going to be able to kill it.
Mm-hmm. I completely agree. So, of course, we are working together with Sarah Palmer to sequence these both RNA and DNA sequences from these patients, so we will have a better idea of what viruses come out. With regards to increasing or at least to enhancing the detection of these viral transcripts, then I really agree that it's probably in the long run necessary to combine a reactivating agent with something that enhances the cell's ability to detect virus and to kill it.
Thank you very much. I'm sorry, but for we are running late, and we have to move to the third plenary talk given by Joachim Ober. It's about gene therapy and bone marrow transplantation.
So thank you very much for this kind introduction, and hello everybody. Actually, most of you expected someone else up here. Professor Jan van Nunsen was scheduled to give this talk, and for personal reasons he cannot be with us today, and he feels very sorry and apologizes very much, and I try my best to substitute for him here. So this is actually the first slide I lifted from Jan's presentation, and if you talk about HIV eradication, we are touching topics of cure and remission. And as you know, cure is following a more the infectious diseases model, while remission following the cancer model and so on. And finally, it comes down to sterilizing cure, the holy grail of HIV research versus a functional cure. So there are role models for both cases, the German or Berlin patient on bone marrow transplantation for a sterilizing cure, and for example, the Visconti study with the 10% of post-treatment controllers representing more or less a functional cure. So as many speakers during this meeting, we have also to travel briefly from Berlin to Boston to understand the framework of this. And particularly the Berlin patient ignited all this excitement in the field. And I put this up, and you have seen this in Dr. Sherry's presentation yesterday, that slide, that actually I want to point out two things. As you know, these Timothy Brown received two bone marrow transplantations with homozygous delta 32 CCR5 knockout. And actually what is, and for years now he is off of the drugs and is also free of HIV, so the only person so far cured of HIV. So it is telling us that latently infected cells or reservoirs can be eliminated. But the big if is by which procedure? And one cannot emphasize more than enough, actually, that this person underwent two total body irradiation procedures. I mean, a single procedure has a lethality rate of 20% already, so you cannot do this at an average AIDS patient. And also, he also suffered from severe graft versus host disease. This, in addition to CCR5 knockout, might have caused the cure or eradication of HIV. And as a matter of fact, at the moment, we don't know what was most important to cure this patient. So things changed a little bit to the Boston patients, and the big difference in the Boston patients was that also three patients, one passed away, unfortunately, received allo bone marrow. And this was the big difference to the Berlin patient, was wild type for CCR5. Another big difference was that both patients were, for the entire procedure, on combination therapy. And they were not irradiated, they received a reduced intensity conditional system. So for up to 3.5 years on heart, there was no detectable HIV DNA and RNA, and the question was, what happens then? And you know the case, the clinical course of these two patients, there were no virus detectable, and then they were put on an analytic treatment interruption. What happens then? There was much excitement, 8 to 15 weeks post-treatment interruption, no virus rebound, RNA negative. So this was causing a big excitement in the field because it was reflecting back on the Berlin patient, somehow indicating that maybe CCR5 knockout is not even necessary to cure an HIV patient. But there was sobering news later on. In the meantime, both patients experienced HIV rebound. So thinking about transplantation, allogenic transplantation or autologous transplantation, there are some questions. And they are not answered so far. How much chemotherapy plus minus irradiation is indeed needed? Or is this the full body irradiation wiping out the reservoirs? Is this the cause for a cure in Timothy Brown? Do we have stop heart until engraftment? How much immunosuppression is required? Do we have to protect the transplant and cells from reinfection? Is graft versus host disease required to eliminate latently infected cells? And how good is the functional quality of the transplanted cells? So this is all touching whether we may in the future achieve a sterilizing or a functional cure. Let me put that here, make it clear from my point of view, a sterilizing cure is, as I said, a holy grail, but whether this is also, from my point of view, a vision, whether this can be achieved at all in the future, we don't know, but nevertheless, we should try. So thinking about generic therapies, and this is I lifted from a old review from John Rossi, basically the way to go is autologous transplantation of patient cells. One can do this either collecting T cells from the periphery or certainly if we are going for a sterilizing cure, stem cells. So T cell transplantation, most experts agree, will lead to more, maybe lead to a functional cure. If we are talking about really getting rid of the virus, we have to go for stem cell transplantation. So the sperm and patient case was so attractive and so positive, yeah, that certainly the idea was now take the patient's own stem cells or T cells and modify them, knock out the CCR5 gene. And at that time, the technology were CCR5 specific zinc finger nucleases. So these are modular designer enzymes that contain a DNA binding domain, which you see here. They act as dimers, one molecule, the other molecule. You have a DNA binding domain, and they also are fused to the heterologous nuclease domain. So they introduce double strand breaks into the DNA. And this may also cause a problem, because then you generate three DNA strands, which are a serious danger signal for the cell, and are urgently repaired by cellular proteins, namely by the non-homologous end joining pathway. And this pathway fixes the lesion, introducing or removing some nucleotides, thereby kicking out the gene of interest, in our case, the CCR5 gene, out of the reading frame and inactivating it. But if you think about it, in some cases, the wild-type gene will be restored. So by using these technologies, you never will achieve 100% inactivation of your target gene. So the system was actually tested by Paula Cannon in California in humanized mice. And she has also reported some antiviral activity on viral load, but also protection of CCR5 treated cells. So what's the problem with this approach? As I mentioned already, there are particular CCR5 specific zinc finger nucleases are plagued by so-called off-target effects. There used to be two Nature papers actually investigating CCR5 ZFNs, and as a matter of fact, particularly the CCR5 zinc finger nuclease is able to target at least 14 human genes. Yeah. So now considering a gene therapy for HIV eradication, you probably have to think twice to put a CCR5 zinc finger nuclease in the human stem cell by facing that many off-target effects. And the other thing is, as I mentioned already, the double-strand breaks, which actually is causing chromosomal instability, and this is the most dangerous signal in the cell. So there is a significant oncogenic risk to zinc finger nucleases or to this type of technology. So now people are actually working hard to substitute zinc finger nucleases. As a matter of fact, in the lab, this is a technology of yesterday. So new technologies include TALENs, transcription activator-like effector nucleases. So the advantage here is that the DNA binding domains are much bigger, so one can achieve better specificity. But it's still sometimes a pain in the lab to generate this type of designer nucleases. And the most advanced systems are the CRISPR-Cas system, an RNA-guided nuclease, where the nuclease here indicated in blue by itself is not binding the target RNA. It's targeted towards your gene of interest via a small RNA molecule. You only have to express the RNA. The RNA is hybridizing with the target, and then the nuclease binds to it. Now, this will be probably the systems in the future to minimize off-target effects, certainly, and they are much faster than zinc finger nucleases. The problem here still is that upon binding, the digesting of the target DNA, production of free DNA, and double-strand breaks is just the same as with zinc finger nucleases. Also here, we face an increased oncogenic risk using these technologies, so double-strand breaks. we shouldn't forget. So nevertheless, Sangama Biosciences from California went ahead and was just published in New England Journal of Medicine with their first study on zinc finger CCR5 specific zinc finger nucleases. The idea was to take HIV subjects, aviramic on heart, isolate their T cells, put in an adenoviral vector expressing the zinc finger nuclease. The vector is called SB728T, and reintroduce basically the cells into the same patients and follow up this. So the efficiency was between 10 and 28% of disruption in these targeted cells of these patients. Okay. Was an open-label, non-randomized, uncontrolled single-dose study. They had a study population of 12 patients, two of them with high CD4 T-cell counts following heart, so-called immune responders, and one another cohort of six with lower CD4 counts. And the idea was basically the study objectives, safety and tolerability, change of CD4 counts, persistent distribution of CCR5 disrupted cells. So I have only two data here. They reported increased CD4 T cell counts from baseline, as you see here, over time for 8 months in both patient cohorts. But when it comes down to antiviral effects, they took the first cohort, so the immune responses off heart of combination therapy for 12 weeks, and basically in every patient they detected easily viral rebound. There was just one patient here in green color who controlled his virus infection, but it turned out later on that this patient was already heterozygous for the CCR5 delta 32 mutation. So on the other hand, one couldn't expect any significant antiviral effects, because if you calculate, maybe you have a maximum of 1% of genetically modified cells in the body of the patients, and the best you can expect is a transient inhibition of HIV, but not even that was observed. So to summarize this, one can say there was a successful adaptive transfer of autologous CD4 T cells. The modified cells persisted in vivo with a half-life of almost a year. Upon treatment interruption, there was slower depletion of modified than unmodified cells, but rebound of viremia, and an improved and sustained increase of total CD4 T cell counts. But after all, every patient received 10 billion T cells. One should expect an increase in total CD4 T cell counts. So at least one can say the procedure is well tolerated and safe, but certainly it's far from being used in HIV eradication approaches. At least one has to consider then, if this is the goal, to put it into stem cells. With all the problems in the biology of zinc finger nucleases, I have my doubts whether this will be allowed by the overseeing agencies, particularly in Europe. So if we go back to genetic therapies and you think about these, then some general thoughts about this. So what is the main reason for the failure of gene therapies? It's just too little numbers of gene-modified cells in the treated patient. How can we achieve success with low numbers of transduced cells? It's possible if the gene product has also a bystander effect. It expresses, or the gene product constitutes a secreted or immunizing gene product. It has also an effect of the neighboring cell. Or the gene product, the antiviral gene, has a selective advantage only. So we see it in vivo selection. So whether this takes place, it's not really known. Whether we see really this selection in vivo over time. There are just two little studies. This is at the moment more or less an assumption. So if we go back into history, many different genetic approaches had been used, or antiviral genes had been used. And we talked about the zinc finger nucleases already, but people express antisense constructs or RNA interference I had been involved in the early 90s in expressing transdominant RAF mutants or TARD and RRE decoys of fusion inhibitors. But most of them are actually, it's actually a sort of a genetic heart. Yeah? You take a pill, as long as you take your pill, virus replication is inhibited. As long as you overexpress your antiviral gene, virus replication is inhibited. Which means that for most of these approaches, you have to overexpress your antiviral gene constitutively in hematopoietic cells for the rest of your lifetime. So what this will happen with respect to biosafety, side effects, or so on, we don't know at the moment. So this actually, whether we see this in vivo selection, will be also affected which step in the HIV replication cycle we target. So we have a patient, a subject here, contains HIV-infected cells that replicate HIV. Certainly the patient contains then cell upon treatment, gene therapy that contain the antiviral gene, or the antiviral gene and HIV. And depending which step in the target, we will inhibit, maybe we block de novo infection like in CCR5 knockout, or we target a post-integration step, or even maturation or release. This will certainly affect how good in vivo selection, if it occurs at all, how good this will happen here. So now we talked about CCR5 inactivation, and certainly it's very attractive from the ideas I just presented is to target a very early effect. Another possibility to target this is inhibition of virus entry. I just give you an example. You know all the T20 peptide, which is a fusion inhibitor in salvage therapy in the clinic. And actually, Professor Dorothy van Laar, together with Jan van Lunzen, their idea was just to basically express this peptide as a membrane-bound version, so that every potential target HIV target cell is displaying on its surface a fusion inhibitor. A peptide is called MACE46. And actually what they did, they put this already a few years ago into patients, and not much to surprise, into the T cells, there was no antiviral effect. At least they reported some increase in CD4 positive T cells in these patients after the transfer of MACE46. There are additional studies in the meantime in primary cells, which were mixed with non-transduced cells. So you have primary T cells transduced expressing the fusion inhibitors, about 10% of the cells, and you mix this with non-transduced inhibitor-free cells, 90%, and in fact this co-culture. And what you can see here easily is that you see protection or survival of these fusion inhibitor expressing cells. There's a newer study by Peter Gems in blood, seeing basically the same phenotype on rhesus macaques, although these data are based on just two macaques, so more or less it's a case study on monkeys. Nevertheless. So the other thing I want to briefly touch is targeting, going directly to the root of the infection, targeting the integrated provirus. And I only want to mention this briefly because later on I have another brief presentation where I will show you the newest unpublished data on tree recombinase. So the idea is to also to design a nuclease that specifically recognizes the LTR sequences of clinical isolates and taking out the integrated proviral, so therefore directly attacking basically the reservoir of HIV. In other words, reversing infection on the cellular level. And we published this before, but can show this really nicely in tissue culture and get rid of the integrated proviral DNA. The only point I want to make here before I come to my end is that this tree was obtained by Guérir recombinase, which is actually well introduced into lab practice all over the world. And the important thing here is that it acts, it does not produce free DNA ends. It's extremely precise, and there is no error-prone process, and therefore there is no oncogenic risk connected to such technologies. And I think this has some advantage.
If you put the jump to your conclusion, because...
We have the conclusion already.
Yes.
And as I said, so what we expect, or what I expect over the next years, is that we see more and more designer nucleases introduced for advanced eradication strategies in HIV disease, because here we can achieve high specificity, and we can also use these nucleases for conditional expression. We don't have to overexpress it for the rest of your lifetime as a patient. So if this, at the end of this, this is a night view of Hamburg, it's the city hall, and I thank you for your attention. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Joachim. Just one question.
One quick question with one quick answer, please. If not, we can move to the three selected, thank you, oral abstract, and you are one of them.
Yes. And perhaps you know that in football, Lyon don't like Saint-Étienne, and Saint-Étienne don't like Lyon. It's the contrary in virology, and I'm very happy to introduce the first speaker, Delphine Vernion-Misicha, and in collaboration with my friends Thomas Bourlet and Bruno Pozzetto for the VREX study. Thank you very much.
And to allow me to present you the VREX study. And in this study, we want to assess the impact of pre-hard blood CD4 plus T cell level on the rectal reservoir in long-term HIV-1 treated men. So, first, I would like to remind you a few important data about gout and HIV. The gout represents the largest reservoir of HIV-1. It contains large numbers of memory CD4 plus CCR5 T cells, and it's also an anatomical sanctuary, which means that the virus is quite protected from antiretroviral therapy. There's a high viral replication within the first day following infection, and the gut viral reservoir establishes very early in the course of the infection. The gout is also an important reservoir of HIV-1 because a lot of of intestinal T lymphocytes expresses alpha-4 beta-7 integrin. This is the main intestinal lymphocyte homing receptor, and it is also a receptor for GP120. It acts like a co-receptor with CD4, and it facilitates the entry of the virus in the cell. So alpha-4 beta-7 CD4 plus T cells are highly susceptible to HIV infection. So during HIV infection, there's an important depletion of intestinal CD4 plus T cells because of the viral replication and bystander's effects. And the loss of Gh17 cells, which are CD4 plus T cell subsets, involve in epithelial barrier integrity and in immune defense against extracellular bacteria, impair mucosal immunity. On the opposite, regulatory T cells accumulate in the gut during an infection. So the impairment of the gut mucosal barrier allows microbial translocation and leads to systemic immune activation and disease progression. We already know that these disorders are not fully corrected by antiretroviral therapies, since HIV DNA and HIV RNA are still detectable in the gut of ART-suppressed patients, probably because of persistent replication. CD4 T cell reconstitution in the tract is delayed and incomplete, and there's still a dysfunction of the mucosal barrier because of the loss of balance between Gh17 and regulatory T cells. In a previous study, another team has shown that intestinal T cells still express PD-1 more than what you can find in a healthy patient. So there is still an impairment of the mucosal barrier, there is still microbial translocation, and still a generalized immune activation under treatment. So the question is how to reduce the HIV reservoir size and how to improve mucosal immunity. Other studies have investigated the impact of beginning the treatment earlier or using immunotherapy. And we have decided to look at the impact of the CD4 plus T cell count at the time of the start of HART. So with the VEREC study, we want to compare the HIV reservoir size and the cellular composition of rectal mucosa between chronically infected men on antiretroviral therapy according to their blood level of CD4 plus T cells at the time of the start of HART. So we quantify total HIV DNA and cell-associated HIV RNA in PBMCs and in rectal cells. And we study different T cell subsets in PBMC in rectal cells, CD4 plus T cells, CD8 plus T cells, Th17 and T regulatory cells, expression of PD-1 on CD4 plus and CD8 plus T cells, expression of P24, and the expression of the integrin alpha-4 beta-7. Then we compare those results according to the CD4 plus T cell count at the beginning of HART. We split our cohort into three groups. Group A includes patients who began treatment with CD4 plus T cell counts above 350. And whereas in the group C, patients began treatment with a CD4 plus T cell below 200. So we include adult men, HIV positive, treated since more than 1 year and less than 5 years, with an undetectable viral load, and who have an indication for anorectoscopy for screening for anal cancer. At day one, we collect blood sample in order to quantify total HIV DNA and cell-associated HIV RNA, and to characterize blood T cells by flow cytometry. And then between day 1 and day 30, each patient has an anorectoscopy with 6 rectal biopsies, 2 quantified HIV DNA and cell-associated HIV RNA to perform a phenotypic characterization of rectal T cells and to establish a tissue bank. So up to now, 19 patients are enrolled in our study. 6 in the group A, 5 in the group B, and 8 in the group C. Now, I'm not going to detail this table, but I just wanted to tell you that all the patients, there was no significant difference in terms of time on ART, on CD4 plus T cell count at the time of enrollment, or age. 3 patients were treated since primary infection, 2 in the group A and 1 in the group B. So first, the immunological results. In blood compartment, you can see here, for the CD4 plus CD8 plus ratio, it was higher in the group A, in the group of patients who started the treatment with the higher CD4 plus T cell level. Whereas for the Th17 steroid ratio, it remains quite stable between the three groups, around 0.3, and this is lower than what you expect in a healthy patient. For a healthy person, the ratio is about 0.5. The Th17 steroid ratio negatively correlates with T cell exhaustion. You can see here. The expression of PD-1 on CD8 plus T cells decreases when the Th17 Treg ratio increases. There is no correlation between this ratio and the level of CD4 plus T cells at the start of HART. Now for the rectal compartment, it's quite the opposite. The CD4 plus CD8 plus ratio remains stable between the three groups. It's something that is already known. The restoration of CD4 plus T cells is incomplete in most of the study. But for the Th17 Treg ratio, it's higher and significantly higher in the group C. You can see that the Th17 cells and the T regulatory cells are also higher in the group C. So, distal exhaustion is higher. You can see it particularly on the CD4 plus T cells, which expresses more PD-1 in the group C, just like the Th17 Treg ratio. And we didn't find a statistical correlation between the Th17 Treg ratio and T cell exhaustion, but there's a trend for a positive correlation. And the Th17 Treg ratios negatively correlates with the CD4 plus CD8 plus ratio. So the restoration of CD4 plus T cells frequency in the gut is associated with a lower Th17 Treg ratio. Now, what about alpha-4 beta-7 integrin? It's important because it's quite a connection between the blood compartment and the rectal compartment. And here you can see on the left that the frequency of alpha-4 beta-7 plus Treg cells in PBMCs negatively correlates with the frequency of CD4 plus T cells and the CD4 plus CD8 plus ratio, whereas it correlates positively with the Th17 Treg ratio. So now the virological results. Total HIV DNA in PBMC and in rectal cells doesn't differ between the groups. You can see here total HIV DNA in PBMC and here in rectal cells. There is no significant difference between the three groups, but here you can see the three patients who are treated during primary infection, here and here, and they had the lowest HIV DNA in both compartments. So total HIV DNA in rectal cells correlates with total HIV DNA in PBMCs. You can see it here, though this is a data that is already known. I can't show you cell-associated HIV RNA because we didn't have standardized all the results. But it was detectable in all the samples, and it seems to be stable between the three groups. So in blood compartments, initiating heart with a high blood CD4 plus T cell counts increases the CD4 plus CD8 plus ratio, but it has no impacts on the Th17 Treg ratio. Maybe other parameters could impact this ratio, maybe viral load. And the Th17 Treg ratio negatively correlates with T cell exhaustion. This was already found by another study in which the Th17 Treg ratio negatively correlates with T cell activation during primary infection. In the rectal compartment, the blood level of CD4 plus T cells at the start of ART had an impact on the Th17 Treg ratio, since it is significantly higher in the group who was treated lately. And the Th17 Treg ratio negatively correlates with the CD4 plus CD8 plus ratio, and it also tends to increase with T cell exhaustion. So it's exactly the opposite that what you can see in the blood compartment. This difference is maybe explained by the expression of alpha-4 beta-7 integrin. Maybe there's a disturbance of the lymphocytes homing, or maybe it's due to the increased susceptibility to HIV infection of alpha-4 beta-7 plus cells. So we saw that there was no difference between the three groups in terms of HIV DNA, but patients who start ART during primary infection seem to have a less important HIV reservoir in both compartments. So maybe it's interesting for developing strategy in order to cure HIV, to know that we can't use the same treatment strategy for patients who started treatment during primary infection and during chronic infection. So these preliminary results suggests that initiating ART with a high blood CD4 plus T cells count has no significant impact on HIV rectal reservoir size, but it preserves local immunity even after long-term therapy. The perspective of the studies are to enroll more patients because it's only preliminary results, and it seems to be important to include more patients treated since primary infection, to study other cell subsets, B cells and memory T cells and other co-receptors, to study other virological markers like integrated DNA and two LTR forms, and to study the affinity between the viral envelopes and alpha 4 beta 7 integrin. And I thank you all for your attention.
Thank you very much.